Hello and welcome back to another video. In this video, we're going to take a look at the AI character sheet from the unofficial community patch. Shout out to Showdown, who made this patch available and made the character of the AIs in Strong Crusader moddable. So we will use this patcher to create an AI character today that is capable of killing of 3 wolves at least, if he has some distance. And we will test out various things and show you how the values actually work. First of all, we have to start up with a concept of the character. And actually, we just want a character with a high economic income. Even if he gets sieged, he should be able to produce mass troops. And also with a high defense, so crossbowmen should be our defense unit of choice. The next thing is how we want to optimize our food production. For all of that, we will create an ARV. I will just make some kind of generic round castle that should be capable of defending most enemy attacks. Let's see. So first of all, we will build up a fast and effective castle where we have troops available fast, and also the economy will explode in a rapid fashion. How to make such a castle, you might ask? Okay, so just search the video description. I've made already a video about the AIV editor, the AI Village editor. To get some tips and tricks about it, you can just watch that video. So, now that we have made the AIV file, we are going to look at the AIC. First, we want to install a community patch again. We will just use every fixed vanilla castles for now. We will untick this box later. And also, oh, there are already files here. Oh, I should have, tried it already, so. For now, we just will begin from the start. So we have this vanilla AIC. We use this, you can export it, and you can have it in your AIC folder. I already did this, so we have the vanilla AIC here. And next step is that we will modify our AI. Let's just hit install for now. We have the vanilla AIC, that's fine. And with every fixed vanilla castles. Also, you can have a look at these improvements. Maybe they don't fit you. Yeah, we have set some things, just in case you don't know. Okay, so for now we want to look at this one, and I will explain how it works. First off, we can just back up the character. We will just take the red is stronger than all the wolves. The red should kill easily 3 wolves, so we will take this character. And we just delete its character array out of the vanilla AIC, and then we will rename this one to vanilla no red. And the next thing is we will create two more AICs. First one is the red AIC, so this is our backup, just in case we want to play with the normal red. We post our array here. So what this does is we can combine these two, and then we have all the characters in the game. Now you can have a separate file for each character if you like that. You can tick multiple boxes inside of the patcher, so like this for example. Okay, next thing, we want another AIC for our wolf killer red. And it's also AIC, it's just a text document. AIC stands for AI character. And now we want to modify this one. And how it works is, first thing, we will not start with this character array because the red is pretty weak. We want a character array that actually makes more sense to begin with, and then just modify that one. So we take the one of the wolf, like this and insert it here. If I'm not mistaken, I've done it like this, right? No, we don't want these things. We want to have the red replaced. Okay, so these values, unknown 0 to unknown 5, I don't know what they do. We have some assumed values that we probably know what they do. With some further testing, that should be verified and even be made official in the next patch. And these, we just assume them, so they might not be true, they might just be completely different. But for now, we will just work as if they were these values. Okay, so critical population popularity means when he reaches that, he will even sell more of his goods and maybe delete some buildings to get up his popularity again. We can do this at like 80, maybe. Maybe 75, okay. This is always multiplied by 100, so don't worry about this. There are two zeros in the end. So we want to have a high popularity the whole time, so we can have a steady passive income. So we make our lowest popularity 90 and our highest popularity something like 97. Then he will reach 100 because he's slow at changing his popularity modifiers. Yeah, this first value here is the text tier change. So there are text tiers like giving out a lot of money, so plus 7 popularity from that, or like no tax at all, or like getting some tax. So each tax tier has like they are neighbored with each other, so if he changes only one tax tier at a time, he doesn't change them too fast. That's what we want also. And this is the maximum tax tier that we can have. This can have values from 0 to 11. 0 is plus 7 popularity and 11 is minus 24 popularity. We want him to raise the taxes only until minus 16. So that's why we put in 9 here. The next thing, I don't know what this value does. So if you find any values out, just post them in the comments maybe. So you can just find these values out by trying, getting some errors maybe. But actually, we found out a lot of values already, so we will work with them. So also, we want to have a wheat production. So here we want to have a wheat farm to know which enum it is. We can just look at Saladin. He takes lots of wheat farms and put it here. Every 3 wheat farms, we will have a hop farm. That way we can have a steady hop income. We want to have a total of maybe 8 or 9 wheat farms. He probably doesn't get the whole income from each wheat farm since they might be harassed. So having a little bit extra wheat farms doesn't matter. Like, we have about 16 to 18 bakeries, I think. So only like 6 to 7 wheat farms should be enough. But if they are further away, then he should have a little bit more. So we make the maximum farms here to 9, so this is 9 wheat farms because the hop farms don't count against the maximum farm limit. That way we will have about 3 to 4 hop farms, but we have 9 wheat farms. Yeah, the next thing is population per farm. So if he has 5 population, he will place a new farm. We don't want him to place farms that fast. We have about 150 population total in our castle. That way we want him to reach the maximum amount of farms at around 120. So maybe we put in something about 11 here. Or maybe 12. Okay, so population per woodcutter. So every 4 population he will place a woodcutter until he reaches the maximum woodcutters. We want him to place woodcutters as fast as possible. So we do this to a lower value that is still reasonable. Set this on a lower value. Okay, so the next thing is population per query. We also want him to set up queries early in the game. He probably uses about 5 population per query, so that leaves 4 open each query, and That should be enough. And iron mines he doesn't need so fast, so we will set this to 20 maybe. Yeah, he should be fine with this amount of quarries and iron mines, so we just leave it like that. Maybe one less quarry could help not getting in trouble too much, because as he will place quarries very far away from his castle if he doesn't have stone, and that way he doesn't place that quarry. Okay, next thing, woodcutters. We want a lot of woodcutters to boost his economy as fast as possible. Okay, 20 is maybe a little bit overkill, so make it 15. Pitchricks we don't want. Pitchricks usually can only be placed far away from your castle. If you're lucky, you have pitch nearby, but usually you don't. So that would kill just random workers, and we will also set this to a 300, so you will never place a pitchrick whatsoever. Maximum fast we already explained. So the build interval defines the amount of ticks in game that he waits until he checks for another building to be placed. He checks if he has enough resources for that build step. If he doesn't have, he checks for the next build step and so on. And every 3 game steps he will build something if he has the resources for it. So we shouldn't put this to a lower value maybe, because as he wouldn't recruit troops. He would just blow all his money out for a building, for the building. And yeah, if you put it too high, then he won't check enough, and maybe he doesn't repair his walls fast enough. So 3 should be fine. You also don't want him to rebuild his resources so fast. If he is under siege, then they will get destroyed. He will only have this for destroyed resources. So if they get destroyed, he waits 40 game ticks until he rebuild them. So the maximum amount of food should be 50. We want to sell as much food as possible. We don't want to have any minimum food. Yeah, what this does is, if he has more than 50 food, then he will just sell it. These things have some kind of way. The minimum apples, minimum cheese, minimum bread. He will buy bread, apple and cheese if he falls below that minimum, and he will only give out stuff from his reserves if he falls underneath the popularity. Okay, so next thing is wheat. We want him to have enough wheat for his mills to produce flour all the time. So he will put this at about 12 maybe, same with the hop. Then he has always enough hop and wheat. Maybe we should put this to an 8. Don't need as much hop as wheat. The next thing is the trade amount of food. Then he will just buy wheat and hop in 10, like in stacks of 10. So let's just leave it at 10. Trade amount of equipment we will put a little bit higher, so you can actually use the stacks in his armory as they're supposed to, since usually weapons stack up to an amount of 5. Until he needs a new place in his armory. Okay, so these two values, we don't know what they do. They probably have to do something with the apples and the cheese, since they correlate with them. But we will just like put them to 50 now. This value here defines when he will give out double rations on bread. And actually, we don't want to give out double rations at all. So we just put it to 100, since he's better off selling the food than giving out double rations. Maximum amount of wood we will put a little bit higher, since he can't really have too much wood. And we happily placed 3 stockpiles for him, so that way he shouldn't be limited by the stockpile too much. You can count the tiles of stockpile now, but I will just adjust this if it doesn't work out in game. Okay, so the next thing is stone. He will start with 50 stone. He shouldn't sell any starting stone, but he should sell stone later on, and he doesn't need 50 stone for a tower, he only needs 35. That way he can rebuild quick one tower if he has like the need to, when he stores 50 stone all the time. But the excess stone he will sell. Okay, so everything above 50. Actually, above 55, since the maximum resource variance defines the variance that he can have in the maximum amounts until he really sells all the stone. So if he has 51, he won't just sell 1 stone, he will wait until 55 before he will sell 5 stone. And then go back to a number of 50. That gives him more room for not micromanaging too much and not lagging out the game. Yeah, and using the game ticks effectively. So this maximum resource variance should just stay the same. Maximum resource other is, so for example, we want to have flour. We don't want to have only 10, we should put this to like maybe 18. That way we can store some flour for the bakeries and don't sell it too fast. Also the iron bars will be stacked up to 18 then, and so on. The maximum amount of equipment we will put to 12, maybe 13. That way he can store more weapons and doesn't sell them if he needs them later for his troops. He will only use 5 different types of weapons, so he should be fine with about 18 weapons each without filling up the armory too much. Since he has 2 tiles of armory, that makes a total of 100 weapons possible. Maximum amount of beer, yeah, we can put a little bit lower, maybe to around 10, since he only has 5 inns, and so he has 2 beer per inn left over. This value actually defines when he will recruit troops. If he doesn't have that amount of gold, he won't buy any troops. We should put this lower as we want him to be able to recruit troops as much as possible. We could put this to 100 so he can recruit fire flowers, but we actually want him to even recruit like crossbowmen all the time, even if he's below 50. Below 100, so about 50 gold should be fine. With 50 gold he can still buy 2 times wood, so he can buy 10 wood with 50 gold still to boost his weapon production, and above that he can buy crossbowmen. So these are the settings for his weapon production buildings. We just leave him as they are. We could put in spears here or bows here and also maces here. But since we just buy bows and don't want any spears, we can leave him like that, and also we don't use macemen. So he will sell all the spears and maces that he produces anyways. They don't count to the maximum equipment, against the maximum equipment. And he would also sell all the wheat and flour, but we don't want that. We want him to use wheat and flour, so we put in a none here. You can put in any resource here, so that way he would sell that resource immediately if he has it. Maybe there's a maximum of 15 resources, I don't know, but right now he would only sell spears and maces immediately. The next two things, the unknown 68 and 69, we don't know what they do. Please find it out. This threshold is actually only used in negative ways, so if you put like 1000 negative, then he wouldn't buy any siege equipment until he has at least 1000 gold. If you put minus 50, he waits for 50 gold to put a mangoline or a ballista on a tower. Yeah, this is the delay until he will replace them. We want him to replace them fast, so a short delay is fine. We want to use the siege equipment on the towers as much as possible. So the next two values, we don't know what to do. We just leave them as they are. The wolf is probably fine with them. And we just build the red the same way. Next thing is we want to recruit defensive troops. So these probabilities have to add up to 100, the default probabilities, the weak probabilities also, and the strong probabilities also. This is the probability how often he will recruit defense troops when he is like a normal player. If he is the weakest player, he will buy defense troops 90% of the time. And if he is the strongest, he will buy defense troops 30% of the time. Actually, we want him to buy defense troops as much as possible and then focus on his attacks. So we just put them all to a higher number. Maybe even 96, maybe. a little bit lower for strong, but actually we want him to recruit defense, to recruit all the defense troops until he reaches the maximum amount. We are not going to use any outside defenses. We only want defense troops on our walls. That way we won't waste any defense troops. Okay, the next thing is how often he raids. Since these have to add up to 100, we will just put in a 4 here at each of them. And the next thing is he doesn't, he shouldn't buy any attack troops when he's weak or default, but he should maybe buy some attack troops already if he's strong. And when he maximizes his defenses, he will buy attack troops anyways and also buy some raid troops probably. Maybe we can put some less raid troops if he's maxed out. These raid troops will function as our meat shield in the field. We don't need any defense troops for our farms. So actually the difference between defense walls and defense total are the defense troops that are out on the field. We want many defense troops on our walls, and also we want all of our defense troops on our walls. This number here defines the number of defensive groups out in the field. And this number here, if it's put to 1, they will move. If it's put to 0, they won't. They just stay there in a static defense. Okay, so let's explain these units here. The sortie units usually attack enemy harassing units. So, for example, the sortie units ranged will move up to the last building attacked of yours and defend it. But also our raid troops will do the same, so we don't care about this. We just put it to 0. And the same with the sortie unit melee. We don't want any pikemen to be spawned and walk around and attack enemies. We want some pikemen for digging. If he has only spearmen, he will use spearmen anyways. Since the red is starting with spearmen, they will still dig the moat out. But when they die, he will recruit some pikemen to dig it again, if it like gets filled up, for example. The recruitment interval we would want to put as low as possible. That way he can recruit as fast as possible. But you can put it higher so he could like not produce as many troops and focus more on his economy. For example, while he's weak, he should put like more defense troops, and usually he should focus on economy. And maybe if he's strong, he should also buy more troops. You can change these intervals for each of the states. The higher, the slower he will recruit troops. Okay, so defensive units. He should use European archers, crossbowmen, Arabian archers, like these ones here, and fire throwers. Fire throwers are really OP, and he should use way more crossbowmen than other units. I don't know if that actually does any makes any difference, but we will try it out. That way he will recruit 5 crossbowmen per European archer, per Arabian archer, per fire thrower. But actually I'm not sure if this works out. He has lots of European archers as starting units, so he will put them up at like on his towers first and then buy crossbowmen after that. Okay, so we don't want any horse archers for raid, we want crossbowmen, since they won't leave our castle range too much. Else you can put different raid units too, but then they will move at the slowest pace of the slowest raid unit. The raid unit base defines how many raid units he's sending out at once, and the raid units random defines how many he can put up at random, and maybe even double or triple that. So these will be our farm defense. You can put also knights, for example, then they will harass the enemy quarries and iron mines and farms. You can put in assassins, you can put in fire throwers, you can put in any unit you like. They will just move up to the enemy and attack. So the next things, like these values here, define the siege equipment that he will move out with and harass the enemy with. In our example, that is the wolf here. The wolves will buy 4 catapults and harass our AI with that. We don't want our AI to waste any money for siege equipment moving out, so we would put this to 0. 190 means they will be catapults. If you would have put in a 358, I believe. Let's look it up. 358. He would buy Fire Ballista instead. And you can put in multiple, so he will alternate them. The next value is probably the speed with what they, like how many tiles they move towards the enemy each round. But that's not sure, we have to test this. Our AI should strike hard with lots of troops. The random amount will only be added up if he has like a big economy build up. So we put in some more random troops. If he has the economy, then he can even launch a bigger attack. The next thing is this number here is probably the variance in like on what kind of angle he attacks the enemy. I don't think that is it's quite clear yet. We have to do lots of testing for this value. So just take it with a grain of salt. We just leave it as it is now, the wolf is probably fine. 128 is the amount of troops he will gather before attacking. So we will put in less troops, so he doesn't need to group as many troops before he is launching the attack, the main attack. The 129 is probably the number that means not probably, I've tested it a lot, but yeah, if he has this percentage of troops left after his attack, he will just move in the direction of the next enemy and attack him immediately. Maybe you can test it out and put it a little bit lower, then you can see what I mean. If he doesn't has if he doesn't have 40% of his troops left, then he won't attack the next enemy. If he has 40% or more, then he will attack the next enemy. The 130 we put to zero. This is probably obsolete now, since we have the option enabled to improve attack waves. So we move many troops at once, as he would wait for some time until the enemy castle might be breached by siege weapons, and if some of his siege weapons die, then he moves in. Or if his siege weapons breach the castle, he will move in immediately anyways. Okay, so this one here, the 131, you can see here, is the percentage of troops that have to be gathered after a successful attack. So for example, if he wants to attack the next enemy, he has to gather 5% of his troops at the rally point where he killed his enemy, and then he will move in the direction and decide. So for example, he decides to move back, or he decides to attack the next enemy. And the 132, we don't know what this does, just hit it to zero. So it doesn't interfere with any of our values. But probably it doesn't do anything big, so as you would have already noticed. But if you find it out, post it in the link, post it in the video description. Not in the video description, in the comments. Okay, so these are the siege engines that he will build. We want to hit hard as many tributaries as we can. So these eight, so these are for the attack. We will build up these siege engines. You can also put in something like a tower or some ram, for example. Whatever you put in here, he will build as long as he has enough engineers. So for eight tributaries, he should be okay, with 24 engineers, 8 times 3 is 24. What these two values do, we don't know, we just leave them as they are. He will attack with pikemen. Maybe we can put in a little bit more. If the enemy has a moat, then they will dig out the moat. Attack unit 2 is an attack unit that will move in before the other attack units, I think. I think it's a good thing to put in horse archers here. Usually they attack the economy, but if you put horse archers, they will still shoot while they are moving. And we can put in a lot of them, like 100. We want to breach his castle by hitting the enemy static defense on his ports as hard as possible. If you put some assassins, then they will also move with the main attack and try to open the gates. Maybe they, probably against wolves this is not really successful since they have a lot of defense near the walls. So just in case, Like the wolf is already down, you can put in assassins here. They can try it. Leathermen are usually bugged, so we won't use any Leathermen. Maybe we can use some Tunnelers, but we don't have a Tunneler skill, so we won't use any Tunnelers. The attack unit ranged push usually also pushes in front of the other troops, but it can bug out and just stay around. So it's not really safe that it does push. But we will try it and put another 100 Horus Archers here to breach the enemy and attack his wall defense. These units usually move after the attack, like after the attackers, and attack also the enemy static wall defense, but they can also back out and just stay around. We want to put in at least one group of horse archers. And maybe you can put in three group of crossbowmen, make it 120. These will move in with the attackers. The attack unit 5 is a unit that probably moves in afterwards the other attackers, and you can just use some. No, I think they just tried to hit the gates and the towers more, but I'm not sure. But these actually make damage to structures probably, and pikemen are strong against structures, so we just put in like 20 pikemen. Maybe we can see what they do in the game when we try it out. So siege unit death will only move in afterwards the attack is already launched. They will stay with the siege engines and try to defend them until the walls are breached. We can put in 50 swordsmen here, so they can move up after the attack. They probably hit the hardest, and they are probably able to kill the enemy if any troops are able to. Unknown 161. Okay, yeah, this is the amount of siege death groups he will build up. You can also put in something like fire throwers. And yeah, they would set the enemy cast on fire. We don't want that. That would only kill our attack troops. Yeah, attack unit main. We can define four attack unit mains. These two are just not renamed yet. But the more we put, the more troops will hit the same tile of wall. So we should put in four different troops here. We will put in more horse archers. We are not able to write them yet. Okay, so we put in the enum value. You can look up the enum values in the on the page of Showdown for the community page. And here we put in assassins. Assassins have the 73. So these units will go for the main attack and attack the enemy walls, and then try to kill the lord. Okay, so now we finished with this. So we have to insert it. We will take the wolf killer red and the red vanilla AICs, as well as the red AIC, just in case we want to use the normal red again. And the wolf killer 2 AIV we put into the AIV folder. So into here. And since we want to replace the red, we have to delete all the red castles and rename it to red 1. Now that we're done, we install our AICs to community page by reloading and untick the boxes for the vanilla castles, since we put in our own castle and the other fixed vanilla castles are already in. Untick this box and tick the boxes of the AIC files you want to load, these two. Just reload again just to make sure, and then hit install. Yeah, see you in game for the testing. Okay, so now we're in the game and want to test out our red. First we just want to test if it actually builds the way we want and uses the taxes the way we want. So we'll just give it some gold and look for his castle against some random AI on our AI contest map. That way we can watch in like the best fashion. We have the books, like look at its taxes, and also we have the ability to build things for it. You can download this map for testing and for taking part in the contest. in the AI contest that you can also take part in. It's free, you can even win prizes. Check out the link in the video description for that, and hopefully you find out some new values. Yeah, so actually, it works so far. It produces ale, it produces some food, that's okay too. And also it digs out the moat with the spearmen. It also should set up taxes up to minus 16, so it just uses the food to get up its popularity. Yeah, if it popularity drops below 90, it will reduce taxes, as you can see here, and put more food out. Okay, so far it works. Let's test it on the real map against real enemies. So we just want a normal game against three wolves. So let's just take this map. This map is easy to handle. Wherever we want the red, I don't care. So we just let it here, and I think this has like the biggest oasis behind it, but I don't know. So we just test it like this, and the three wolves should be a challenge. I will speed this process up and notify you if something interesting happens. So these are the first attacks of the wolves, but they actually don't do much harm. As we can see, our defensive front wall to block some catapults actually works the way it was intended to. So what we can see, he uses these ranged sortie units anyways, even though he didn't want him to. I guess they are not raid troops, they are sortie units, so we can put the raid troops to zero and put in some sortie units. He's launching his first attack. We'll be right back. Okay, so there we are. We've managed to defeat our three wolves. We will just make some small adjustments now to the AIC, and then we will make two more tests. Okay, so as we saw, we want to take some small adjustments. These units actually got recruited, even though we set 0 to the ranged max. We want these to be crossbowmen. Oh, damn it. This way. And also, we might want to have more gold available for buying wood, since our fletchers usually just stood around and didn't have enough wood. That we can manage by increasing the amount of gold that needs to be available for recruiting. This should be this value. We just set it to 200. And the next thing was, we want to have a little bit more hop farms, so we just put in one more hop farm. So now that we've managed to change this a little bit, we also might to increase our ranged push units from 100 to 150, since they were lost with not being able to move in as well. And these also take the wards, so we can just leave it like that. So now we make some more tests, and so we have to reload actually. Yeah, see you then. Okay, we want to do two more testings. We also put in two more quarries and one iron mine, just if you wonder why it builds more iron mines now. We want to try the red against five wolves. Also, we will give it more tax income by putting a big advantage for AI. This gives the AI 1.5 times the normal tax income. If you would put it to this, it would give the humans 1.5 times the normal tax income. So let's just start. Look a bit at the build up. So these two towers are very early in the build order. The AI will just buy the stone for them and set them up. This is actually very important and necessary, so it doesn't wait too long until it builds its big towers, else it would not be able to defend the early attacks. But the wolves are usually slow, so the build-up shouldn't be a problem, unless the wolf would be directly neighbored to our AI. So the next test will be neighbored wolves. But for now, let's just speed up the process and watch the game. We'll be right back. Okay, there we are again. And with this final result, I'm pleased. Now we will make one last test. Actually, we give the AI 40,000 and put in two more of these. These should, like, these seven wolves should easily destroy our red. So let's begin. They have Mangalines on their towers, which actually have a lot of impact in close combat. But maybe our red is able to build up fast enough their own Mangaline towers. It's all Mangaline towers. So, as you can see, it favors its economy, uses all its peasants for its economy, which is not ideal. Should probably focus more on putting up the defenses, but it doesn't buy any crossbowman equipment yet. That's sad. At least these towers with the high towers in front are kind of unpenetrable. Okay, they're not being able to get penetrated by arrows. So let's just watch this and have some fun. Oh, look, this is already in flames. I'll just watch a little bit and see how it's going. And then we come to a conclusion. So far, the red is holding up. Impressive, but probably with some more attacking power might eventually fall, but the blue and the green wolf are already done with their gold income. Also, the green wolf is in flames, so they might not be able to recover. That way it will be a 1v5 again that the red is already able to manage. We saw that. Okay, so now you can see the red is again the biggest ruler of them all. It seems like this is not a challenge for him, but I think this is actually pretty close. Because in the beginning, if the wolf, the green wolf for example, or the blue wolf had another castle with more Mangalines, he would probably have died against those. Yeah, I will post all the files, like the AIB and the AIC file, downloadable on a link in the video description. I think I will end it after one of the two wolves or both have died, and then we are in the same situation as the last test. I hope you keep watching my videos. Maybe you want to take part in the AI contest, so the AI design contest where you can manage to kill all the enemies the fastest with your AI and then win some prizes. Yeah, this should be hopefully a video where you have learned something about creating that AI. Maybe you even have some suggestions or questions, so post them as comments in the video description. And the rest of the video I will just leave for you to watch this sped up, and yeah. See you soon. Bye for now. Okay, so there we are. I guess this concludes it pretty well. Download the red and play against it yourself. You can also replace any other AI character. Just replace the index and the name. Yeah, bye bye.